Bhagavan, we dedicate a song to you.
We will sing to Amma three times.
Shall we start with the questions, Bhagavan? Bhagavan, the first question, Bhagavan. What makes those who are fully enlightened so different? Are they not reaching the same stage? Some have great humor, some do not. Some teach, some do not. Some tell jokes, some do not. Some laugh and dance, some people remain silent and sit.
The enlightened ones do not engage in daydreaming. That is what makes them different from the normal person. All normal human beings indulge in daydreaming, whereas the awakened one or the enlightened one does not engage in any kind of daydreaming whatsoever. Even when you are enlightened, the personality remains. That is why some after enlightenment continue to be humorous, some are serious, some become teachers, some become silent, because the personalities continue even after enlightenment.
Next question, Bhagavan. What makes one become a great enlightened teacher?
If the one who has become enlightened has suffered greatly before enlightenment, he becomes a great teacher.
Next question, Bhagavan. Next question, Bhagwan. Can you give a definition for compassion? Please share to us how to express compassion and teach us how to learn to express it.
The physical heart has to undergo a physical change to develop compassion. And for that to happen, the brain has to undergo certain changes before the heart undergoes a change. Only that leads to real compassion. However, you could start by practicing compassion, which is not true compassion, by putting yourself into other people's shoes. As you keep practicing this, changes do happen in the brain, and then it is followed by changes in the heart, and you discover real compassion. So you could start by practicing compassion, which is not real compassion.
Bhagwan, thanks for giving all of your gorgeous teachings. It really helps us a lot. When I came back from India, deepening course, I really felt so refreshed in my life. I felt like everything has changed because of my change in mental state. But after a few weeks, I started to go back to the state I had before I went to India. I feel so confused about life and don't have any passion in everything. My question is, at the last day of our deepening course, the guides told us if we want to rise our level of awakening, we need to do Chakradhyana, give and receive Diksha every day. But I really don't have any passion on it. I just don't want to do anything about it. And I really want to keep up an awakening state. So do I need to force myself to do the Dhyana or give and receive Diksha, or I just need to go with my heart, don't do anything about it?
If you do not have any passion, it means you have arrived at an important milestone. This is a significant milestone, and you must not move away from there. You should just stay with the fact that there's no passion. This staying with the fact would give you the breakthrough.
Bhagwan, I feel like I'm dying soon, but I don't have any idea why. I would like to contribute the rest of my life to the world, but financially there is obstacle for doing so. What can I do for that? Would you please help me to solve the financial problem? And would you give me self-love, Bhagwan?
This feeling of dying is a psychological process, which means you are dying to the past. This process, which you feel as though you are dying, is a perfect process. All people who get awakened go through this process, and I will fully bless you for self-love and solving your financial problems.
Dear Bhagavan, we love you. Today, Hong Kong has a lot of negative energy flowing, including passive, depression, selfishness, etc. People are facing extreme problems. Recently, the weather in Hong Kong is getting abnormal. Dear Bhagwan, would you please give deep blessings to Hong Kong, China, and the whole humanity?
Yes, I would certainly give the blessing.
Sri Bhagwan, in the oneness teachings, you have mentioned about experiencing the pain so that the charges will be liberated and become free. Would you please teach me what to do practically and how to do with experiencing the pain? How to make myself focused with full attention on the experiencing? And what can I do to discharge myself from the charges? I am in deep gratitude to your help and answers, Bhagwan.
In oneness, suffering is the shortest path to awakening. In oneness, when there is suffering, you should not move away from that suffering. You should not escape that suffering, but fully immerse in that suffering or stay with that suffering. And then the suffering itself becomes joy. But how to do that? You could start with some small physical pain, like a small ant biting you. Now, try to stay with that pain of the ant bite and slowly move it to the psychological realm. Start with physical pain, not big pain, but small pain, and then move it into the psychological realm. You would soon discover the art of staying with suffering. When that happens, all else is automatic. That is why we say staying with the suffering is the first step. It is also the last step. There's nothing more to do.
Hong Kong has recently been given tremendous grace to have sacred chambers. It's a good news for the oneness family in Hong Kong. Those who have done the sacred chambers have their problems solved, like health, relationships, finances, and so on. So everyone wanted so much that their family members and friends also can join. I have two questions, Bhagwan. For those who are new to oneness and for those who are the first time to join the sacred chambers, what kind of attitude or state of mind should they have so that they can receive the maximum benefits?
They must have an open mind, and they have got to realize that they are going to make use of the divine to help sort out their problems. They are going to fulfill their own personal needs, and the divine is of their choice. It is not any divine imposed on them. It's completely their choice. They could choose their divine. It could be a Christian divine, an Islamic divine, a Hindu divine, or a Buddhist divine. It's all in their own hands. It's up to them. And they make use of divine power to sort out their health problems, financial problems, relationship problems, and whatnot. So it's exactly making use of some powerful being to help you and who's willing to help you. That's all.
There are some people who do not believe that the sacred chambers could solve his problems, but because of curiosity, they did join. Will these people receive any benefits from the sacred chambers?
Believers, non-believers, atheists, communists, you could be anybody, still you would receive the divine grace.
I am engaged in medical work, and I need to be logical and use my mind alone. After I am awakened from the deepening coma, my brain has started changing and my heart also started the transformation. Now I have some conflicts, Bhagwan. When I witness something happen that could not be explained, then my mind will tell me, do not believe into something happened that could not be explained. How should I respond, dear Bhagwan? For example, I often hear people talking, when you do not have money, do not think that you do not have money, but you have to feel that you will get rich and wealthy soon. But the reality is that no money is no money. How can one feel that he will become rich? Is it a bit self-deceiving?
Consciousness has tremendous power. When you develop wealth consciousness using oneness teachings, you find you actually acquire wealth. When you develop health consciousness, you do acquire health. When you do develop success consciousness, success comes to you. All this could be experimentally verified. Normally, it acts within 7 days. So one need not believe in the power of consciousness. It can be verified. It could be tested. So you could make use of it to change your consciousness and to succeed in the world.
Bhagwan, I want to tell you that I love you. My question is, Bhagwan, I want my divine live in my home physically and be my wife, but I don't understand how it could happen. I don't totally believe it and understand it because I am a disciple of the Buddha, and the Buddhist Sutra said everything with form is unreal. So I am confused and struggling. On one hand, I want a physical divine. On the other hand, I feel like my divine should be formless. What should I do, Bhagwan? Please help me understand totally that my divine would be physical with me.
Whatever is strong in you, that would happen. But the fact is, there are a lot of people around the world today who are physically living with their physical divine. It's happening all over the world now.
Dear Father Bhagwan, we notice that there is a big change happening in Oneness University, including the news of your retirement this year. I feel sad because we may not be able to see you as frequent as now. But on the other hand, I feel glad that you and Amma can have more time for yourselves. I have two questions, Bhagwan. Will the Dasaji is able to travel to different cities in near future? We are eager to see Chandraji visiting us in Hong Kong.
Oneness is full of possibilities. Anything could happen in oneness.
What is our role as oneness trainers in the coming years, Bhagwan?
It is for you to take forward oneness and help transform the world.
Bhagwan, we all love you. Dear Bhagwan, would you please share what is oneness? To our friends who are new to oneness, how does oneness help and influence one's relationship and one's life? What kind of exercises, any, can be easily put into practice in daily life? Can you share with us what is sacred chamber and what are the functions? Dear Bhagwan, thank you for your love to me, to my family and to Hong Kong.
As individuals, we are fragmented inside. As families, we have divisions. As a society, we have fragmentation. As a country, we have fragmentation. As a world, we have fragmentation. We have different belief systems, different ideologies, different economic systems, and whatnot. Everything is creating a division. And this division is leading to conflict. Now, oneness starts with the individual. It brings about oneness in the individual, which leads to oneness in the family, which leads to oneness in society, which leads to oneness in the country, which leads to oneness in the world. Where there's oneness, there would be the absence of conflict. Where there's no oneness, there would be conflict. So oneness aims at bringing about individual peace, and through individual peace, bring about world peace. As far as practice is concerned, Oneness recommends Chakradhyana, but you could follow any practice. It could be Tai Chi, it could be yoga, it could be some meditation. You could follow any form of practice with which you are comfortable and which suits you. Oneness does not say this is the best practice or that is the best practice. Since we are used to doing Chakradhyana, we talk about it. But it is not that that is the only practice. It's up to you to choose any practice with which you are comfortable and you're happy with. As far as sacred chambers are concerned, sacred chambers are places where your divine becomes physical to help you directly. And it is thus fulfilling many ancient prophecies all over the world that when the golden age comes to the planet, the divine would walk and talk with man.
Dear Sri Bhagwan, how are you and Amma? My deepest greetings sent to you and Amma. Almost 2 years have passed since you announced that I am awakened on August 31st, 2012, during your darshan. Time flies. I have never got a chance to back to oneness again after September 2012. But I do miss oneness every day. It is like a heaven in my heart. With the blessing of awakening, I work quite productively in my daily job and there is no pressure at all. After 1 year and 8 months work in my current position, I strongly felt that I am ready to step up and take the next level leading position. So here comes my question. How should a great leader act in terms of spirituality? Shall we provide enough freedom for this? Or use the position to practice our awareness and impact more people through the platform?
A great spiritual leader is one who is non-positional, and your platform to help others.
Sri Bhagwan, currently the financial system, education system, housing policies, and even the climate in Hong Kong are on the verge. How could we apply oneness to a high vision for the future of Hong Kong? What practically can the Oneness Hong Kong community do for Hong Kong?
All problems arise from your levels of consciousness. Lower levels of consciousness, which created these problems, cannot solve these problems because they are the cause of these problems. So the best way to solve these problems is by raising the levels of consciousness. And that is the work you have got to do. As collectively, the levels of consciousness goes up, the problems would come down.
For the people born in Hong Kong after 1980s and 90s, their behaviors are so different from the group of population born in the 50s and 60s. These younger age people, no matter how hard they work, it is not as easy to become successful as the older people in terms of job promotion, the level of salary increment, and it is very difficult for them to buy a flat for themselves. The conditions of the society are so tough for them to survive, not to mention about their happiness level and their interest in spirituality. Dear Bhagwan, the question is, since the future of a society in the hands of the younger people, they are living to strive to survive while they may have forgotten their dreams, vision and passion and living life unfulfilled. How oneness can help them to become great leaders of our society? What can we do for these younger people in our society? Thank you, Sri Bhagwan.
Strangely, these young people would start growing very fast from the year 2015. The sacred chambers would play a very great role in transforming these young people and help them grow dramatically.
Sri Bhagwan, we have tremendous freedom in choosing our religion in Hong Kong, and within a family, different family members can choose their own religion. For example, Christian, Catholic, Buddhism, Islamic, Muslim, and others. When we share oneness to them, most of them feel that we are trying to make them change their religion and resist it. And in fact, we are not. What can we do to help these people to understand that oneness is not about making them to change their religion? And instead, oneness in fact helps people to experience their lives fully.
Oneness is not a new religion. Oneness is like sugar, which you could add to coffee, tea, or milk. Oneness helps a Christian to become a better Christian, a Muslim, a better Muslim, a Buddhist, a better Buddhist. It helps you to communicate with your divine and receive the grace from your divine. It does not impose anything from outside. It only works within your own faith. It is not something external, not trying to change anything at all. It helps you to truly become like the great mystics of the past. That's all.
Sri Bhagwan, recently you have mentioned about making use of the divine to fulfill our human desires by going to the sacred chambers. And there are about 30 types of sacred chambers. Would you please help to explain to us what would be the best sequence of the chambers to go and why? There are people who are non-oneness questioned about, if we keep on going to the sacred chambers and get our desires fulfilled, then will it become another excuse to escape from living our life and working hard in our job? Or is it just a question from the mind?
First, you must go to the chambers where karma is cleared. After that, you must go to the chambers where you are reprogrammed, that is, your fate is changed. Then you must go to chambers where your ancestors are cleared. Then you must go to chambers where all curses are removed. People are basically cursing each other and they are quite effective. The curses must be removed. After having done all these four things, then you could go to the chambers where you get money or health or relationship or marriage or whatever you want. But these four are basic and fundamental.
Dear Sri Bhagwan, please bless me to have a life partner very soon who has the same vision to contribute to oneness. And please bless our oneness works to be smoothly carried out in Hong Kong.
I will bless you to have a wonderful life partner.
This is the last question, Bhagwan. I feel very fortunate to know about oneness and Sri Bhagwan. I came across a problem recently. I don't know much about Bhagwan. Then I started to read oneness literatures and I confess that I am unable to connect the relationship between Bhagwan and oneness. When I was asked by my friends the origin of oneness, I have not got any clear response. And yes, I really do not know about the history of how Bhagwan started the oneness work. I am empty inside about the origin of oneness. Can Bhagwan talk about how he realized the origin of oneness? Thank you, Sri Bhagwan.
In oneness, the teaching is important, not the teacher. The teacher must be forgotten.
And finally, Bhagwan, the Hong Kong oneness team is very grateful, Bhagwan, and seeking Bhagwan's blessing, Bhagwan.
Love you all. Bless you all.
And we would like to pray in the presence of Sri Bhagwan. Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.
Love you all. Love you.